Hello, Tobias.
Hello, everyone.
Hello. Welcome to Embedded Fest online. So, how are you today?
I guess I'm pretty fine, a little excited and a little nervous, but that won't stop me to give you a great talk, I guess.
Yeah, that's great. So, Tobias, you are an author of TinyGo, yeah, creative DIY microcontroller project. And you will talk about this project today. Is it correct?
Exactly.
Okay.
And I'm talking about a little IoT project I built for my personal use at home. And I guess I'll also have one or two words about the book I wrote at the end of the talk. So
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. So, dear participants, stay till the end and you will get some notes about the book from Tobias.
Okay, so hello everyone again. I hope you enjoyed your day so far. As I just said, we are going to talk about IoT in TinyGo, and I guess most of you might not have heard about TinyGo yet, but that's no problem. So we start pretty basic with an introduction. So we are going to have a look at what is TinyGo. And well, what does TinyGo bring to the table? And then we are going to look at a little project I built. So more or less, we have a full introduction here. So even if you have not yet used the Go programming language yet, no problem, you should be still able to follow. So yeah, what is the agenda? So first of all, what is TinyGo? Then we have a small look at the Arduino Nano 33 IoT microcontroller board, and then we will are going to dive into some code where I'm going to explain how to set up a Wi-Fi connection. Then we are going to look. Then we are going to send some data over the network, and then, depending on the time, we might have a live demo, but I also prepared some screenshots, so we'll see how it works. So first of all, what is TinyGo? In short, it's a new compiler for Go code and a new implementation of a Go standard libraries, and a little bit longer, maybe. The TinyGo project is an open source project founded, I guess, in 2019. So it's, well, more or less nearly 3 years old now. It became an officially sponsored Google project in, I guess, 2020. And well, the new compiler is written in Go itself, and then the results are being handled into the LLVM compiler toolchain to further optimize the code and compile it into the binary format that microcontrollers understand. So the goal of TinyGo is to bring Go to microcontrollers and to also to WebAssembly. So you can also compile your Go code using TinyGo compiler toolchain to deploy WebAssembly applications, which is pretty nice. And what is meant by it's also a new implementation of the Go standard libraries. Go brings a really feature-rich standard library for features like HTTP clients and cryptographic libraries and so on and so on. So there's a huge standard library in Go, and also TinyGo re-implemented all those packages. So having a new compiler has some benefits. And for example, let's have a look at the most basic Hello World program I could imagine in Go. So we have a package, our main package, which contains a main function, and it just prints "Hello World" to the console. Let us just check if it works. Yep, that works. So we have 4 lines of code, more or less, which print "Hello World." Now, if we compile that program using the standard Go compiler, and yeah, if we just compile it using standard Go compiler, in this case it was compiled for a Linux system, and we result in a binary with about 1 MB of size, which is pretty huge if you try to fit it on a microcontroller, because, well, it won't fit on most microcontrollers. And this is where TinyGo is able to shine. So we can use nearly the same commands as in the standard as the standard Go command. So instead of Go build, we just write we just say tiny Go build. Then we can also set the path to where set the path where we want to have our binary and give the path to our main file. So these parts are similar to our standard Go compilation. We have two more arguments here. So when building a project for TinyGo, we have to set a target. And the target could be an Arduino microcontroller, a target could be an Adafruit microcontroller, a target could be WebAssembly, and so on. I'm going to talk about these targets and benefits a little bit later. And as we have a really, really, really simple Hello World program with four lines of code, we don't actually need a garbage collector, so we just say, well, don't include a garbage collector. And this is going to result in a binary of, well, about 1,300 bytes, which is compared to the 1 megabyte we have with a normal Go toolchain, a pretty nice decrease in size. So this can fit onto nearly every microcontroller I'm aware of. So, and this isn't even the smallest. Binary you could possibly build. I guess the smallest TinyGo Hello World program I did flash on a microcontroller was about 400 bytes, which is pretty, pretty awesome because that leaves us enough space for our program code. Okay, so far for the comparison. So a new standard library has some benefits as well. For example, the packages of the standard library are optimized to run in small environments. We also have a so-called machine package, which is new to Go because the Go itself does not contain a machine package, but TinyGo contains a machine package. We'll talk about the machine package later on in more detail. And also having re-implemented the standard libraries and having the machine package built into TinyGo means we do not need so many external libraries from the internet when we are building simple microcontroller or even more complex microcontroller projects, because we have everything we need in one place. So for the machine package, the machine package is implemented per microcontroller board. So currently, TinyGo supports around about 70 microcontroller boards. And in these lists are lots of boards from Adafruit. We have lots of Arduino boards, like the Arduino Uno, like the Arduino Nano 33 IoT, and lots more. And as I said, these are implemented per microcontroller board. So TinyGo makes heavy use of compiler flags. All the code for other microcontroller boards is being sorted out during compilation. So we only include the code we actually need in our binaries to, well, we have smaller binaries. The machine package also offers constants for all pins. The machine package also offers access to all interfaces on a microcontroller board. So you can use the machine package to use the SPI interface or a PWM interface or access an I2C interface and so on and so on and so on. So it really feels like a embedded built-in, it's a built-in feeling. You don't need other external packages just to talk to some SPI device, for example. And now to re-implementing complete Go standard library also leads to some disadvantages. For example, not everything is implemented yet. Here's a screenshot of a list of supported packages. I have linked the list in the slides. I'll also share the slides online and and so on. But for this example now, we can see like MIME type package is implemented, fully implemented more or less. The net package is implemented or is able to build, But for example, the net HTTP package, which provides an HTTP client and an HTTP listener, is not fully implemented yet. And there are some also some more packages which are not fully implemented. So that doesn't mean the TinyGo community has stopped implementing these. It just takes a little bit more time to implement one package after the other, until we maybe someday have the complete Go standard library re-implemented for the use in microcontrollers. So to sum it up, what is what was important in this section? So TinyGo executables are really, really small compared to Go executables. So TinyGo is a perfect way to, if you want to write Go code for microcontrollers or WebAssembly. The microcontroller support is directly integrated into TinyGo and the standard libraries, and but some standard libraries are not yet completely implemented. Okay, our next topic. So in the examples to follow, I was using an Arduino Nano 33 IoT. And now to the most important specs, we have 32-bit ARM-based microcontroller, and also the Arduino brings pretty powerful Wi-Fi co-processor. So we have more or less two processors on this little chip. So if you haven't seen one yet, that's an Arduino Nano 33 IoT, pretty small, but yet still pretty powerful. So we have an ARM MCU, we have a Wi-Fi coprocessor, and we have also an inbuilt temperature sensor, which we are also going to use. And the Arduino Nano 33IoT is based on 3.3 voltage volts. So it's a newer generations of my it is in the newer generations of microcontrollers. Older microcontrollers mostly used 5 volts, but this one runs on 3.3 volts, which I think is pretty nice. So why did I choose this microcontroller in general? The short answer is it is fully supported by TinyGo, which is good. So all interfaces are supported. So I can use GPIO, I can use UART, I can use SPI, I can use ADC, and I can use PWM interfaces, and so on. So it's basically a pretty good choice. Also, the Wi-Fi support, the Wi-Fi coprocessor is supported, and the onboard sensors are supported. So for using TinyGo, it is more or less a perfect fit currently, at least for my use cases. And in summary, so we have a 3.3 volts microcontroller board with a powerful Wi-Fi coprocessor and very, very, very good TinyGo support. Okay, now we can dive into the code itself. So for the project, the introduction part is done, and now what was the project about? I wanted to measure and monitor the temperature in my living room and in my bedroom at home. And I what I did was I used these Arduino Nano 33 microcontroller boards, two of them to be exact, and I placed one of them in my living room and one of them in my bedroom. So as they are capable of Wi-Fi communication, I set up an MQTT broker on a Raspberry Pi, which is just, well, why a Raspberry Pi? It doesn't drain that much power, so I have not that a bad feeling to let it run 24/7. So I have a Raspberry Pi with an MQTT broker on it, and that enables me to send messages from my microcontroller to this MQTT broker. And I also have a WebAssembly application also written in TinyGo that monitors, that receives the messages from the MQTT broker. And so I have a dashboard where I can monitor the temperatures at home. And the dashboard is also able to control the lights in my room and start my coffee machine and so on. But for our example, we concentrate on monitoring of the temperature. So Let's have a look. I guess I'm going to explain a little bit more, just assuming not everyone of you is very familiar with Go. So what do we do? And as our first step, we define a new, we are in a so-called package Wi-Fi. So we have a Wi-Fi package, which gives us some functionality to connect to a Wi-Fi network. So the first thing we do is we import the machine package I already talked about. And packages that do not contain a URL-like structure like this second import here, like the tinygo.org package, are built-in packages from the standard libraries. So you can see the machine package is a built-in package in TinyGo. And the second package we are importing is the Wi-Fi Nina driver package, because we have a Nina coprocessor on our board, and so we are using this package. We define two constants here. The first one is the SSID, so the name of our Wi-Fi network. And the second one is the password of our Wi-Fi network. Of course, I changed the values here, so I don't leak my personal Wi-Fi data here. And then we are setting up two variables. First one, we grabbing the SPI interface from our machine package. And the second one is the adapter that enables us to talk with Wi-Fi, to connect to a network and so on, and send data over a network and receive data over a network and so on and so on and so on. So after setting up the variables, we need to configure our SPI adapter, our SPI interface, and our network adapter. So what we're going to do is we call the configure method on our SPI object and pass in an SPI configuration. So the first thing is we set a frequency of 8 megahertz. It could also be higher, I guess. The Nina chip also supports higher frequencies, but 8 megahertz is fine for our use case. Then we just set the pins for the SPI communication, and luckily we have constants for the pins and so on. We are not sending the least significant byte first, and so on and so on and so on. Okay. The next one is we are setting up our Wi-Fi connection. So we call the function new, pass in our configured SPI interface, and also pass the chip select pin and so on and so on. So we just pass the pins we need to communicate with the adapter, which are also luckily also constants in the machine package. And the last step to configure our wireless adapter is to just call the configure function, which internally sets up everything which is needed for us. So after the setup function, we are ready to use our Wi-Fi coprocessor. Next one. So the next step, logically, after setting everything up, is trying to connect to a network. The first thing we do in our connect to access point function is, well, we sleep. And now why, you might ask? Because internally, for the Wi-Fi coprocessor to be ready to do stuff, it needs some time. I guess it needs way less than 2 seconds, but I just stick to like 2 seconds sleep, because then I'm more than 100% sure everything is initialized and set up and ready to go. So the next step is here I'm calling the println function, which is a built-in function in Go. You can use println to print stuff to your console when having a terminal program, CLI, and so on. And in TinyGo, when running on a microcontroller, the println function prints prints to serial. So if you monitor the serial port on your computer, it is going to print out connecting to and then the name of SSID we defined earlier. So In the next step, we set SSID and passphrase in the adapter. And this also triggers the connection attempt to our network. So after setting SSID and the passphrase in the adapter, the coprocessor, the Wi-Fi coprocessor, is going to try to connect to the network. And the next logical step is to, well, check the connection status and maybe also wait for the connection to be successfully established. So, and this is exactly what we are doing in this next block here. So what we are doing here, if you're not really familiar with Go, Go only has one loop. So there's no while loop, there's no do while loop and so on. There's only a for loop, and you can use the for loop for everything you want. You can use a for loop just like a while loop and so on. So what we're doing here is having a loop. We initialize, declare and initialize a variable st, which we use to save our status. We get the status from the getConnectionStatus function, and we want to stop the loop. We want to do it as long as our connection status is not status.connected. So if we have this, if we receive a status connected, well, we have successfully established a connection and we can stop this loop. The next step is we just print print the connection status to serial again. It greatly helps when debugging. Then we just sleep for a second because it doesn't really make sense to check the connection status each millisecond, because it takes, I don't know, like 3 to 4 seconds maximum to establish a connection to your network. And at the end, well, we are just grabbing a new status and then checking the status again, and so on and so on. And as I said, when the status is connected, we drop out of the loop and print connected to serial. So we now know, okay, we have just successfully established a connection to our Wi-Fi network. Okay, to summarize this block. So what have we done? We have initialized our SPI interface and our Wi-Fi adapter. We have set an SSID and passphrase and have successfully connected to our network, hopefully. So, yeah, next one. Okay, the next step, after establishing a connection to our Wi-Fi network, we want to establish a connection to our MQTT broker. For that case, we have defined another package, and I might not have explained packages. Packages behave like in other languages, like in, I guess in Java you have also packages. You have packages in JavaScript stuff and so on. In C Sharp there are namespaces, and packages are just a collection of different files in Go and packaged under one name, for example, MQTT client. So we have an MQTT client package. The first thing we do here is define the URL or the address of our server. A little more info here. For the next, let me say, months at least, I have an open MQTT broker on my server, so the MQTT broker does not need any credentials and so on, but also does not support TLS. So if after this talk you want to try out this project yourself, but you don't want to set up an MQTT broker or your and so on, you can just use the MQTT broker of the example here. But if you do, if you use this MQTT broker, keep in mind, first thing, it is the data is not encrypted, not even the connection is encrypted. And second of all, it is open in the internet, so don't send any sensitive data over this broker. But if you just want to try out this project, feel free to use it. as I said, it will be there in the next months. And if for some reason this broker is not available anymore, you can just, there are some free brokers to use in the rep. You can Google for Mosquito MQTT broker test and you will find some for test cases. So to summarize, this is the address of our MQTT broker. Okay, the next thing, we want to initialize an MQTT client. For this reason, we have a function called new client, which returns an MQTT client. And the MQTT client comes from the MQTT package, which is implemented in a TinyGo repository. So what do we have to do? We just, first of all, we need to get a new client options object, and we receive one by just calling new client options in the MQTT package. Nice, we have our object. The next step, we need to tell the options our address of the server, and also we need to set a client ID, so the name of our client which connects. And for that case, I just called a TinyGo dash IoT and also a random string. I have not yet the random string function just generates a random string with the length of 8 characters. I have not included it in this slides here, but it's included in the GitHub repository. If you're interested in it, I'll give you details later. So after setting up our options, we can just create a new MQTT client, pass in our options, receive a new client, and then we can return it. Nice. Okay, next step. We have now have a client, and we want to connect to our MQTT broker. So we define a function connect, pass in the client as parameter, and might also return an error in the case something goes wrong. So we're printing some information to a serial, and the next step is recalling the connect function on the client, store the result into a token, then we call token.rate, so we wait for it to finish its stuff it's doing internally, and then we are checking if the token returned an error. If it returned an error, we are returning the error, and if it did not return an error, well, then we are now successfully connected to our MQTT broker and could now subscribe to topics or send messages. The next one, the keyword or the buzzword was we want to send or publish messages. So we need another function here. The publish message function, we pass in our client as our connected client as parameter and also a temperature, which is represented by an integer value currently. So the first thing we do is we format, we prepare our message. To have an easy case, I'm just sending a JSON-like message and have a small binary. And so I did not pack in any other dependency into our project. So we're using the format or FUMT package, how it is pronounced mostly, and use the value we get divided by 1000 and print it into this value into this JSON object right here. So we receive a string object, which is our message. The next thing we do is we just publish it to our broker by calling the publish function on our client. We publish it to the topic embeddedfest/tinygo/iot/temperature. We're using the QA bit 1, so we make sure our message is received by the broker and so on. And also pass in the message. That are the important bits right here. Then we wait for the function to execute, and then we check if the token returned an error. If the token returned an error, well, we check what the type of our error is. In case we have a Wi-Fi Nina error, that would mean we might have lost our Wi-Fi connection. And for the sake of easiness, I have not implemented some trying to reconnect cycle in here. And also, it's not really important in my project at home that, well, I receive every message every minute. I can live with it if I lose a message because something went wrong. So I'm just calling system reset on my microcontroller, which is a hard reset on the microcontroller. So it reboots and loads the program again. And during the initialization of our program, well, we set up a new Wi-Fi connection to hopefully solve our problem. And if it's not a problem with our Wi-Fi connection, well, we print it to serial in case we want to debug it. Yeah. So that's it for publishing a message. The next step is to put everything we seen before together. So we have our main package, just like in our Hello World example from the beginning of the talk. So in the the main package always contains a main function, which is the entry point to our program. What we are doing here, we are, as I said earlier, we are using the temperature sensor from the microcontroller. And to be able to talk to the temperature sensor, we have to configure our I2C interface, then get a new instance of our sensor by calling new and passing in the configured I2C interface. Then we have a new instance of our sensor object. The next step is to configure it, to call configure. This sets up everything for the use of the sensor, and then we are returning an object of the sensor, which is then ready to use after this function. The next function, initialize MQTT client, more or less calls everything we've seen earlier to set up our Wi-Fi connection to connect to an access point. So we set up the Wi-Fi connection, connect to the access point, create a new MQTT client here, have the instance of a client, then trying to connect to the MQTT client. And also if something goes wrong here, well, we print the error, sleep for a second, so we have the chance to see the message in our serial interface, and then we just reset our system if something goes wrong to have another try. And when everything ran nicely, well, we can just return our client. So we are still in the same file in this case here. So just, well, we're still in the same main package. And now we are having a look at our main file. So the first thing we do is we call the initialize sensor function we just seen in the last slide. Then we call our initialize MQTT function we seen in the last slide. So we have those two objects right here. Now we define an endless loop. So we have, it's like a for loop without any parameters in here, just behaves like a while true loop in other languages. So this one runs forever. So the first thing we do is we check if our temperature sensor has a connection. If not, it might not be ready yet. So we just continue to check the status again, and at some point in time, like after some milli or nanoseconds, the sensor is going to be connected and going to be ready. We are going to skip this if statement, can then call the read temperature function on the sensor, receive a temperature, and maybe an error. If we receive an error, well, we just print it to serial for debugging reasons. We could It might also be a good idea here, as we used hard system resets on other functionalities, like when connecting to MQTT client or connecting to Wi-Fi. In our case, it could also make sense to do a hard reset here, just to, well, let it reinitialize everything in the hope it is able to do it now. And also for debugging reasons, we are printing out the temperature to serial. So we can, while debugging and developing, we can just plug in our microcontroller to USB and monitor the serial port. And then we call our publish message function to publish the message, obviously, hand in the client and the temperature. And then we sleep for a second until we have another go in our loop. That's it. That's more or less the complete code in our main package. And looking at the time, I guess we're going to skip the live demo and just looking at the screenshots. So I've used a program called MQTT Explorer. This is a graphical MQTT client, which is able to connect to MQTT brokers and show us the messages which were published to the broker. So what we can see in the screenshot, we connected to the server at newbiegames.de and looking at messages in the embeddedfest/tinygo/IoT topic, and we can see the temperature has our formatted JSON object here, like the value is 27, which stands for 27 degrees Celsius. And yeah. So these messages are let me start again. I explained earlier that I also have written a WebAssembly dashboard in TinyGo, and this WebAssembly dashboard also connects to the MQTT broker and fetches the messages and then puts the messages into a table. So I have a nice overview of the history of the temperature in my home, and I'm able to see if my radiators work or not. And if I might have to adjust the temperature of the radiators. So in general, if you are interested in TinyGo or would like to learn more about TinyGo, I highly suggest to follow the official TinyGo account on Twitter. If you have Slack, you can also join the TinyGo channel on the official Gopher Slack. So there's an official Slack server just for the Go programming language. Also, I you should really, really, really follow La Pipa TV on Twitch, because that program hacks there on microcontrollers, and that program, alias Ron Evans, is one of the core maintainers of TinyGo, so you can learn a lot in the streams. So he, one of his last projects was to he built a controller for a drone. So he built a controller with buttons and sticks and so on to control a drone using Bluetooth and so on. And it's always really interesting to watch and listen him hack, as he also explains lots of stuff there. Also, it is always worth to visit the TinyGo site, which you can find under tinygo.org. And I can assure you, the TinyGo community is one of the nicest developer communities I have ever witnessed. So I had lots of questions over the past years, and I always get a nice and considerate answer. So check out the TinyGo community. And as explained or as said in the introduction, I also wrote a book about TinyGo, and as the image doesn't really show us how big this book have gotten, just so you get a hint how big this book is, explaining everything you need to know about TinyGo, it took me several months, where I nearly worked every day on it. And it is the first book about TinyGo. So I have the honor to present you the first book about the topic of TinyGo. And what do you learn when reading the book or working through the book? Well, first of all, how to set up TinyGo and your integrated development environment, or also how to get wie language server support in normal editors like Vim or Notepad++ or whatsoever. It also teaches you most of the basics of microcontroller development. So even if you have not yet developed any program for a microcontroller, no problem. The book will guide you through everything you need to know for the project. So it's a pretty hands-on guide. It consists of 8 chapters, and each chapter implements another project. For example, an automated plant watering system project. We have a touchless hand watch timer, which uses an ultrasonic distance sensor and a 7-segment display to display the time. So you just swipe your hand in front of the sensor, then the timer starts and you see and counts down. So you wash your hands long enough, which is pretty important in the current times. It teaches you how to use the GPIO, SPI, I2C interfaces and so on in TinyGo. It teaches you how to write your own drivers in TinyGo in case there is just no driver for the display you need or for the sensor you need. It also teaches you how to use the Wi-Fi libraries of TinyGo, and it also teaches how to build a WebAssembly project in TinyGo. So now you might ask, where can you get this book? Well, basically at every bookstore at the world. If they don't have it in stock, they can order it online. You can also find it on Amazon, Google, I guess if Apple has a bookstore also there. And so you basically just Google Creative DIY Microcontroller Projects with TinyGo and WebAssembly. You will find a link where you can get the book. So I'd say that's it from me, more or less. So thank you for attending. Thank you for listening. And I really sincerely hope I sparked your interest in TinyGo. And if I have seen it correctly on the timeline, I guess there is also another talk about Go and maybe also about TinyGo from Patricio, who is also a very, very, very active member of the TinyGo community. So if you're interested in that, I guess in the next time slot, the talk from Patricio takes place. So maybe also go to that talk and listen to him to maybe learn a little bit more about TinyGo. So again, thank you everyone for coming here.
Yeah, thank you, Tobias. You definitely sparked the interest because we have lots of questions in the chat. Unfortunately, we are out of time, but I encourage you and our participants to join Zoom room for this live discussion on TinyGo. So please join the Q&A Zoom room. You will find link under the broadcasting window. And you can continue the discussion there. And Tobias, thank you once again for conducting a talk at the Embedded Fest. And we really, really appreciate it, your support of our embedded community.
Also, thank you. It was an honor to be here.